morning, and welcome to this week's lesson on Come and Follow, our ongoing adult education series at Central Presbyterian Church. I'm very glad to be with you again as we continue our journey to explore what it means to be a believing disciple of Jesus Christ. Let's open in prayer. God, we come to you with grateful hearts, grateful for a night of rest, grateful for a new day dawning. It's full of possibilities to follow you, to learn about you, and to embrace you as our Lord and Savior. We pray for your blessing during this time as we talk about what it means to be a disciple and what it means to be a follower. We pray that you will bless us and keep us and guide us. In the gracious name of Christ, we pray. Amen. You may or may not know that today is Reformation Sunday. I know, shocker, how did it possibly sneak up on you? But really, this day on the church calendar is a great opportunity to be reminded of God's mighty acts in and through Jesus Christ. The acts of some courageous people. And yes, that throughout history, God's people have missed the mark, sinned, fallen short of God's glory. Just like in the book of Judges that we looked at last week. Today, our jumping off point is Martin Luther, who I would argue was the first great reformer of his time. I happen to have a picture of him to show you today. During the time of Martin Luther, and many years leading up to his time, the Catholic Church dominated the social, political, and domestic scene. The Church enjoyed power and prestige, and controlled most every aspect of human everyday life. It was corrupt in many areas, such as selling indulgences, which were necessary for salvation and their understanding. The Pope had complete power and believed that the scriptures, written in Latin, should not be put into the hands of the people in their own native languages. Now, Martin Luther could not just continue to see the corruption in the church that he loved so much, and he could not keep silent. So he spoke up, and a revolution or a reformation began. Now, Martin Luther was a Catholic priest, a professor of theology, a prolific author, and composer of countless hymns, such as A Mighty Fortress Is Our God, which just happens to be one of my favorite hymns. He also became a key central player in what is now known as the Protestant Reformation. He was born in Germany on November 10, 1483. He was ordained as an Augustinian monk in 1507 and appointed a professor of theology at the University of Wittenberg in 1508. It was during this time he came to reject several teachings and practices of the medieval Roman Catholic Church. I want to make note that we're not talking about the Catholic Church of today, nor are we talking about the Catholic Church we affirm in the Apostles' Creed, which begins with a little c, which means universal. Martin Luther particularly disputed the view on the selling of indulgences. Now, basically, indulgences could be purchased in order to reduce the punishment you are owed for your sin. Buy an indulgence for a loved one, and they would go to heaven and rather not burn in hell. Why did the church sell indulgences, you may ask? Well, the early church sold indulgences as a way of getting quick money. It's believed that the building of St. Peter's Basilica was funded by the selling of indulgences. Now, Luther took great issue with the selling of indulgences, as he should have. In response, Luther proposed to engage others in an academic discussion of the practice and efficacy of indulgences and the role of grace in salvation. In response, he did what they did back then. They did not have Facebook or Twitter, so he nailed 95 theses or complaints to a church. church door in Wittenberg on October 31st, 1517. Now, the purpose of nailing these theses to the door of the church was not to separate the Catholic Church he loved so much, but rather to reform it from the inside out. Martin Luther never intended to form a new church, but that's exactly what he did. Luther believed that we are saved by grace through faith and not by our own works. To Luther, Romans 3:19-28 summed up the whole gospel of Christ for him. So take a few minutes to find your Bibles or your devices, Romans 3:19-28. I'll read it for us. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be silenced, and the whole world may be held accountable to God. For no human being will be justified in his sight by deeds prescribed by the law, for through the law comes the knowledge of sin. But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been disclosed and is attested by the law and the prophets. The righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. There is no distinction, since all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. They are now justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a sacrifice of atonement by his blood, effective through faith. He did this to show his righteousness, because in his divine forbearance he had passed over the sins previously committed. It was to prove at the present time that he himself is righteous, and that he justifies the one who has faith in Jesus. Then what becomes of boasting? It is excluded by what law? By that of works? No, but by the law of faith. For we hold that a person is justified by faith apart from works prescribed by the law. Luther believed that we are justified or made right with God through the gift of grace given by God through our faith in Jesus Christ. We are not justified through the law or by our own works. Take a minute to reread and think about this passage from Romans. What does it mean to be justified by grace rather than works? What does it mean to be justified by faith, by grace, rather than by works? How does this make you feel? That our works have no part in our salvation? What part does our faith play in our salvation? What part does our faith play in our salvation? How would you describe grace or define grace? Are grace and forgiveness different? Are grace and forgiveness different? As God has extended grace to us through Christ Jesus, we are to extend it to others. How have you seen or experienced this in your life? I'd like to share another Bible passage with you. This time it's Galatians 2:15-21. Jews and Gentiles are saved by faith. We ourselves are Jews by birth and not Gentile sinners. Yet we know that a person is justified not by the works of the law, but through faith in Jesus Christ. And we have come to believe in Christ Jesus. we might be justified by faith in Christ, and not by doing the works of the law, because no one will be justified by the works of the law. But if, in our effort to be justified in Christ, we ourselves have been found to be sinners, is Christ then a servant of sin? Certainly not. But if I build up again the very things that I once tore down, then I demonstrate that I am a transgressor. For through the law I died to the law, so that I might live to God. I have been crucified with Christ, and it is no longer I who lives, but it is Christ who lives in me. In the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not nullify the grace of God, for if justification comes through the law, then Christ died for nothing. Take a few minutes to reread this passage of Scripture. Then there's some questions to ponder. What does this passage say about justification, or being made right with God? What are some ways modern Christians present distorted pictures of Christ's gospel of grace? Present distorted pictures of Christ's gospel of grace. There have always been those who feel that too much emphasis on grace encourages people to live however they want to live with no consequences. Is this a valid concern? If so, how would you respond to someone who leans too much on grace? What does justification have to do with following Jesus as a disciple? What does justification have to do with following Jesus as an example, as a disciple? What are some ways you see modern believers living by rules rather than living by faith? Out of the actions of Martin Luther and others like him arose a renewed biblical understanding that we are saved by grace through faith by the power of the Holy Spirit. What also arose is that we are a church reformed, always being reformed by the power of God. That is, we are constantly in a state of being changed by the Holy Spirit. We're not a stagnant church set on rules and regulations, but rather a dynamic one, always seeking to be faithful to Christ in our time and in our place. Two final questions today. What in the church needs to be reformed by God's grace today? And what might you and our church do differently through the reforming, restoring power of God? I mentioned in the beginning, Martin Luther was a great hymn writer, and I'd like to share with you the second verse of Luther's hymn, A Mighty Fortress is Our God. It reads, did we in our own strength confide, our striving would be losing. Were not the right man on our side, the man of God's own choosing. You ask who that might be. Christ Jesus, it is he. Lord Sabaoth his name, from age to age the same. And he must win the battle. Thanks be to God that we are saved by grace through faith by the power of the Holy Spirit. Let us pray. Almighty and merciful God, we give you thanks for your word, the good news that we are saved by grace through faith and not by our own works. We pray that our works may be an outflowing in response to what you've already done for us in Jesus Christ. Be with us as we go forth into our day, ever mindful that you are with us, beside us, behind us, before us, and carrying us along the way. We pray all of these things in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. I'll see you next week. Goodbye for now.